Hey everybody, welcome to Tech Tuesday. I'm Rick Usey. Today's topic is CALEA. What is it? You'll find out in just a second. Hey, thanks for joining me for Tech Tuesday. My name again is Rick Usey. This is my Tech Tuesday broadcast that I do live every Tuesday at 3 o'clock. And this would be on topics that are generally of interest to broadband service providers. Today's topic is CALEA, so why don't we start talking about that? You may be familiar with CALEA. Could be something that remember from way back when, let's say 2005, when this was first mandated. This is an unfunded mandate for law enforcement. It stands for the Communications Assistance for Law Enforcement Act. So if you're in the broadband business at that time, you no doubtedly heard of this in one form or another. You hopefully implemented a solution, but maybe not. There were some people that said, we just can't do this, and that's not a good idea. There could be some of you that are new to the broadband business. There have been a lot of companies, electric membership co-ops, cities, and just others that are expanding into broadband, fiber companies that may not be aware of this. So it's something you do need to be aware of. So that's what we're going to cover today. So first off, what is CALEA? So again, it stands for the Communications Assistance for Law Enforcement Act. So the whole point of this is to try to make it easier for law enforcement officials to be able to do their job. And the reason it originally came into being was because of telephone, tapping telephone lines. But then as the internet became what it was today and back in the 2000s, they needed a solution for that as well. So this requires that communication service providers assist law enforcement agencies in executing lawfully authorized electronic surveillance, including live intercepts of voice and data packets from service providers. So basically, if you provide voice service, whether that's traditional POTS service, or if you provide VoIP, voice over IP, or if you are a broadband service provider providing any kind of an internet connection, then this applies to you. So it applies to pretty much everybody. So originally, like I say, CALEA came about in 1995. And it was meant to address digital phone switches because, you know, at that time, prior to that, a lot of the switches, you know, you think about switches, it literally was pulling a wire out from one place and putting in another in the early days, right? But even later, you know, the switches were not digital, so it was a lot easier for law enforcement to be able to do wiretaps. And that got more difficult and even really close to impossible with digital switches that didn't necessarily support that. So they enacted this law in 95. And they were forcing equipment manufacturers to get, switch manufacturers to get their equipment to a point where it could do these intercepts of data and phone calls, really phone calls in that case on a digital switch. And that was pretty much, that was done pretty quickly. So by 1996 or so, I believe most major switches had upgraded their equipment to be able to handle this. But it was expanded in 2005 to include the ability to do surveillance on broadband accounts as far as data. So VoIP, yes, but also just data transfer, being able to see, you know, emails in real time and what people are looking at on the web in real time, what they're doing on the internet. So that was expanded. Again, an unfunded mandate, so it caused a lot of stir on how we're going to do this. There was a lot of uncertainty, but over the next couple of years, it kind of sorted out and a lot of folks got their CALEA compliance in place. We're going to be talking about that today, just so you can kind of get up to speed on this if you're not, but also so you can maybe have some feeling of comfort that you're doing what you should be doing if you are. So here's what CALEA is not, and sometimes this is confused by people. So it's not associated with the DMCA notifications that would be sent for copyright infringement. So you may have seen these where you might have a subscriber that's got a particular movie that they are hosting, you know, that's on their on a server or generally on their PC, and maybe they're using some file sharing software and they're offering that to the world, and you'll get an email from an attorney that says, hey, you can't do this. And then as a service provider, you actually have some responsibilities there to notify your subscriber, let them know that that is up there, and tell them they need to take it down. And if they don't take it down, what you're going to do, in other words, terminate their account. That's all very important, because if you have that in place and you do those things in a reasonable fashion, then you have safe harbor under DMCA and you don't need to worry about what your customers are putting up on your servers. If you don't know about it, you don't need to worry about it, but if you're informed of it, you need to do something, which is let your subscribers know, make sure that they get it off, and if they don't, terminate the account. But this is not DMCA stuff. So it's also not your typical LEA or law enforcement agency requests for historical information. So again, you might have seen these where you'll get a notification, a subpoena, the sheriff comes knocking on your door, something where they'll want to know, or the FBI, they'll want to know who had a particular IP address at a specific time. So you're looking back at historical information on that that they might want to look at, you know, in other situations. They might want to look at somebody's historical bank records or historical emails, or a lot of times it's just IP address where, you know, it's like who was using this IP address on this particular date because maybe there was some child pornography involved or some other kind of criminal activity. And again, you want to, you know, reasonably you want to keep that data like 90 days, but that's just looking back at, for example, at your IP records, you know, who was using different IPs. So this is not that. What it is meant for lawful intercept requests and real-time monitoring of voice calls or data transfers. So this is like a phone tap. This is actually listening in on somebody's phone, let's say for a VoIP call, or you could even be watching just as if you're right there in front of the screen, like you might do on some kind of screen sharing log me in kind of service where you're actually seeing what they're doing at that time. There are some requirements for the law enforcement agencies, and these are stricter than your typical kinds of things, let's say, for where you just might need a subpoena to get some IP information, or maybe even some pen register, I forget what that is, but if you're just getting historical data, the bar is not quite as high. But if you're going to be actually doing live surveillance, it's a high bar. So you need a court order signed by a judge or magistrate authorizing and approving that interception of wire or electronic communications, or other authorization, and then there's a code here that's referenced. And a lot of times you'll hear of these when you get it's called a wiretap order or an intercept order or a Title III warrant. Title III is the law or the legal requirements for surveillance, which, you know, for the FISA courts, that kind of thing. So you need this kind of bar in order for somebody to be able to request this. So you need to be able to author or see that these things are authorized. You can't just have somebody hand you a piece of paper and then say, okay, sure, because you're really doing something significant here. So you need to make sure that any authorization that you get is absolutely legal and authorized. These are lawful intercepts. Very important. So what requirements do you have? You have to be able to execute any valid warrant, like we talked about from one of these, you know, one of these court orders, for surveillance on any user in a timely manner. We'll talk about timely here in a second. So you need to be able to respond quickly, and that would be for any user. So if they tell you this particular subscriber, you need to be able to have access to be able to surveil that subscriber. You have to begin doing that, delivering and intercepting the traffic to the LEA within 48 hours of receiving that court order. That could be including identifying info, you know, who it is. If it's, let's say if it's phone calls, you know, who's calling who, what calls are they making, who are they receiving calls from, if they're sending emails, you know, same thing. You know, who these players are, but also, again, possibly the content of communication. So it may not include that. So I think it would be real specific on the court order as to whether you are actually going to be doing live surveillance of the communication or just providing information on who the players are, who the actors are in this particular communication. You have to maintain confidentiality, integrity, and authentication of the communication identifying information. That's very important. So the point there obviously is that whoever it is that's being surveilled, they can't know about it. So that's important. And also you want to protect their privacy. It could be that they're innocent. So you could be surveilling somebody who's innocent. You need to be able to protect the identity of any other people that are associated with that communication or any other subscribers that you have. So it's very focused on who, what information is provided and on whom. And you have to maintain that confidentiality. And as part of that, you have to have in place, and I'll talk about that in a moment, you have to have in place some strict policies on who has access to the information, who has the ability to set up this live surveillance, and then who can, if anybody can, knows that it's going on. You don't want your whole company to know that, oh, you know, Joe Smith down the street is being surveilled. The FBI came in and gave us a court order. So you can't have that. It's very controlled on the information that you provide. Now, if you can't comply with this in a timely manner, there's up to a $10,000 a day fine from the courts if not compliant. I believe the FCC can also add to that as well if you're not compliant. And you could be forced, you know, the courts could say, you know, that you need to come into compliance with a certain date. So you'd be fined, plus then you got to spend all the money to get expedited compliance in place. So just something to be aware of there. If you're not prepared, you need to be prepared. This is something that you have to do. There are safe harbor requirements if you are compliant. FCC is satisfied if your solution uses industry standards. And there's a couple of industry standards right here that, you know, with the numbers and everything that you can look up. I don't know all the information, but more than likely, you don't need to worry about this unless you were going to be developing your own compliance solution and not purchasing or using a third party. So this would have been, for example, for switch makers and others that were, you know, putting this into place on or mediation devices that are going to transfer this information to the LEAs, follow these standards. So really what you just need to be aware of is that whatever solution you're employing follows these standards. It's not like you need to figure all of this out yourself. So what are your options? So there's a few different options. You can develop your own compliance solution, like I was just saying, but I don't think many people do that. That would be very complex as far as, again, creating, you know, figuring everything out, creating all of the technology to be able to do that, following those standards. I don't think a lot of people would do this. And you're going to have specific skills in your organization. And then if those people go away, then you've got to replace those skills. So not something that I think most would do. You could purchase a compliance solution. That would be, you know, all of the information and that you need and the equipment. That would be the probes that you need to be able to receive the feeds from the subscriber that you're surveilling or subscribers. That would be the mediation equipment. So once basically what happens is you have a probe that streams that to a mediation server that then takes that data and puts it in a format that it sends to the law enforcement agencies that they can use. So you can't just send them this stream of stuff. You've got to get it mediated and then send it to them. So you can purchase a compliance solution where you get the probes and the mediation device, kind of expensive. And then it says here it needs to be replaced as your network grows. So you have to have a certain throughput. And then as your network grows, you may have to be replacing that. So that's maybe not the best way to do it. Or, you know, you have to add additional probes as your network grows. Depending on how you want to deploy those things. So it's just something to be aware of. And then thirdly, it would be using a trusted third party. And this is something that is recognized by the FCC as a viable solution, is something that meets the standards, as long as the trusted third party meets those standards. And that will cover pretty much everything. The nice thing about that is it's kind of bundled together. So you don't need to worry about it. And that's one of the things about CALEA is it's an unfunded mandate. And then, you know, it's not something that you see every day. Now, you do, depending on how big an operator is, they could get several CALEA requests in a month. It's certainly very possible. I mean, these, you know, there are CALEA requests happening probably weekly. I think there have been fewer with the pandemic because they've been focused on other things. But there was a lot of activity before the pandemic, and with everything that's going on with cybersecurity and cyber crimes and ransomware, I think we're going to be seeing an uptick again with CALEA requests. So you need to be prepared for it and have everything in place. But a trusted third party can do all of that for you so that you don't need to be thinking a lot about it. There's still some things that you need to do, but that way you can kind of offload a lot of the technical stuff and a lot of the things that have to take place. And we are, I wanted to, just a commercial for us, we can provide trusted third party services. And one of the things that we would do if you come on board with us is we review and engineer the network. So we would see if you what the requirement would be for the probes, how many you would need, might be just be one, or where it could be placed. And you don't actually have to get that probe right then. It's just basically the network is looked at and it's like what size probe, where, that kind of thing. Provide and provision hardware and software to meet the requested CALEA needs, so the probes would be available and ready. Validate, this is important, validate the intercept requests as they come in. So again, you get that court order, and we'd have access to attorneys that can look at that and say, yeah, this is a valid warrant, and then probe would be shipped to you once that's determined to be valid. And then facilitate the connection between the probe and the mediation device. So you don't need to have the mediation device in your network, but needs to be a connection there, and we'd obviously facilitate that, including coordinating a VPN if required. So that's something that we would do. And I forgot to mention, I'll go back to here in a second. So the other thing would be providing the mediation of that. So the probe delivers the data to the mediation server, the raw data, and that sends it in the format that the LEA requires. So that all takes place in the back end as well. We'd ensure that this service meets with the current laws and regulations, and then also anything else that might change, and keeping you updated in that. 24/7 support if needed. A lot of times these warrants come in on late on Fridays when judges have their chamber hours. But you usually don't get them after hours, but you need to have a solution available for that, so we can be available for that, or you can have people online for that. Network reviews as needed, so your networks change. So when your network changes, we would need to be informed of that, but also we like to do a review every 18 to 24 months just to make sure that nothing's changed, take a look at everything, see if everything that we have in place would meet that. Something that I forgot to mention, so a couple of things that you need to be, if you haven't already, you would need to file something, I think it's a form 455 with the FCC, which tells them basically, you know, what you have in place, how you're going to do this. And that's filed with the FCC. Then there's also something called a systems integrity plan, I think it is, a manual. I thought I had a slide for this. I guess I do not. No. So there's a manual that you need to file as well. At one point, it was thought that, I think it was even said that the manual needed to be sent to the FCC. So this manual would be something that would tell, it's really meant for internal purposes. It's your manual on how you will handle CALEA. And it's really about, again, keeping that information close to the vest so that you have only a limited number of people that know anything about any CALEA intercepts that are taking place, and then who those contacts are, so that people within the company know, and so that you're you've got a policy in place. They really want to know that you've got a policy in place to provide the security for any CALEA requests. We have a sample of that if you would need it, for example. So again, we can provide this for you if needed. Just go to zquorum.com/CALEA, and that's all lowercase, and you'll see the services that we can provide as far as CALEA. But again, if this is not something that you're doing currently, then you definitely need to be looking at this. If you are doing it, you've probably got a solution in place. A lot of the larger MSOs might have their own compliance solution in place, but there are a lot of people that are using trusted third parties because, again, it's something that, if you get one a year, it's not something that you want to have a lot of things in place on your own. If you can trust this other third party to take care of all of that for you, that's probably the easiest way to go. So that's what CALEA is. Hopefully this was helpful. If so, feel free to give me a thumbs up on this video. If you haven't subscribed, again, I'm here every week, Tuesday, talking about broadband kinds of issues. Could be DOCSIS, fiber, whatever. Could be regulatory stuff like this. So go ahead and subscribe. If you subscribe, click the little bell there and you'll be notified whenever I'm live. So that's it for this week. Thanks for joining me for Tech Tuesday, and I will be back next week. Take care. Bye-bye.